Let's get connected. I think it's a great pleasure for me to be able to introduce John Bessant. John is originally a chemical engineer. So I think I've noticed that quite a lot with the different speakers that have come up, that they've had quite a different background, like coming from different faculties or areas of science, if you like. So John's originally a chemical engineer. He's a thought leader in technology and innovation management, having written a number of books, some of them which you would know. Arno Meermann actually coined the book, which is Managing Innovation, the Bible of innovation. But in fact, for any of you who have been involved in innovation, it really is the basis of innovation, completely explained in this book. So John is also the chair of Innovation and Entrepreneurship at Exeter University. He's also there the research director. And he's acted as an advisor to a number of international governments, OECD, the World Bank and the United Nations. So with that, if you could help me to welcome John Bessant onto stage.
Thanks very much. Good morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I'm delighted so many of you managed to get up after last night, so thank you for that. And it's great to be here with an audience interested in innovation, because we've got a problem with that word. It's everywhere. I'll give you 30 seconds on any company website before you'll hit the magic word. You know the kind of thing. Innovation, driving the business. Innovation, working for the customer. Innovation, innovation, everywhere. And of course, these days, in the public sector, it's the same story. How do we deal with the huge crisis we've got? Simple. Innovation. All the politicians get it now. So everywhere in the public sector, we hear this magic word. I've just come from a university in Nuremberg, and their mission statement, we were reviewing the university, their mission statement, guess the magic word in the center of it all, innovation. And that's our challenge. It's a really important thing, but the risk is the word has become inflated. It just kind of hangs there as a wonderful banner. We need to get below that. We need to engage with it, and particularly in an audience like this, to challenge ourselves. And that's what I'd like to do this morning. Very briefly, a little bit like an 18th century duelist, I'm going to throw down some gauntlets and invite you to reflect a little on some of the many challenges around managing innovation. So the three I'm going to throw down very briefly, I'll start with the Spengler challenge. I'll then move to the spaghetti challenge, and if that's not enough, we'll have the Sappho challenge. But then let me start with the first one, the Spengler challenge, and pose a question to you. When did you last use your Spengler? Now, I'm pretty sure you all have a Spengler. Some of you might have touched yours recently. I can see some really worried faces now. I'll make it easier for you. If I'd asked you, when did you last use your vacuum cleaner? Maybe it's a Hoover or Dyson, Electrolux, doesn't matter the brand. Here's a useless fact you can take away from the conference. Mr. J. Murray Spengler invented and patented the electric vacuum suction sweeper. Nobody has ever heard of him. But if I said the word sewing machine, I think for many of you a name just dropped into mind, which was Singer. Everybody, all together, Singer. You're all wrong. A man called Elias Howe invented the sewing machine and went bankrupt. Mr. Singer bought the business. Now, they're two of many examples of something we know about. Innovation is not like the cartoons. You know, in the cartoons, bing, light bulb flashes on. That's great. That's an idea. But as we well know, there's much more to innovation than just the idea. The trouble is that the model is quite persistent, and we find a remarkable number of people still having that as their basic idea about innovation. Here's some examples from the US Patent Office. These are all inventions that somebody has believed in enough to take to the Patent Office. The example of the gas-filled umbrella. Oh, nice, interesting thing. I haven't seen too many outside. The musical flamethrower. Little gadget here where if you like hunting ducks, you can go doing that and stay dry. You can't breathe. That's the one slight drawback with this one. I quite like this. If you want to keep your unborn baby entertained for 9 months, there's a little device you strap to your tummy and play nice music. But I think we should give the star prize to the genius who felt the world needed the cheese-flavored cigarette. Now, you've seen this kind of stuff all over the internet, wacky inventions. But they remind us of this hugely important point. Innovation is more than just invention, but we know that. The reason I'm raising that, though, is this is the challenge. In a sense, our mental model, how we think about something, shapes what we do about it, what we pay attention to, what we give resources to, what we manage. So there's a real challenge, first of all, between our ears. When someone says innovation, what do we think about? What does a company think about? What does a university think about when we say that word? Now, the problem is there's nothing wrong with invention. Don't get me wrong. Bright ideas are the fuel for innovation. No problem. It's just that if it's like a jigsaw puzzle, if you just had one piece, it doesn't really make much sense. Now, the good news is we've spent about 100 years studying innovation and beginning to think and understand, often through bitter experience, that innovation is a little more complicated and we perhaps need a richer model. And so in all sorts of research, we've put a picture together which is much more coherent. We've got models of innovation which are clearly well beyond bright idea equals innovation. But we still need to challenge ourselves. I'd like to suggest, in a world of business model innovation, we actually need some innovation model innovation, updating and rethinking our models of how innovation works in what is now a very different context. In a sense, this process has been going on. If you look back, and I'm old enough now to have looked at some of the early research on innovation, our models have moved from fairly simplistic models to now something quite coherent, with multiple elements in it. I was very fortunate when I first started my career to work at Sussex University with somebody called Roy Rothwell. Now, it's very fashionable if you're doing a PhD, you bring all the recent references to bear. The danger is we lose track of where the ideas and where the field originally came from. And Roy was a part of that. He began working, spent his whole life researching innovation management. Along with Chris Freeman and Keith Pavitt and others, he contributed hugely to how we understand the innovation process. And Roy wrote an excellent paper in 1992, and I'd recommend any of you to take a look at it, where he took a kind of backward and forward look at models of innovation. What are the sort of dominant ways of thinking about it which influence the way firms behave, the way governments shape policy, the way universities think about their role? Now, the early generation looked ridiculously simplistic. Back to the 1950s and 60s, science push. You put lots of resources into R&D and magically things happen at the other end. It seems to us laughable these days to think of that. But it was a dominant model. And in many ways, it built a lot of the 20th century industry. Bell Labs, Philips Laboratories, the big German chemical laboratories, these were powerhouses for innovation and led to huge change. Or in the 1960s, we discovered marketing and we realized that we had to understand the user and pull the innovation through. Again, ridiculously simplistic, but we learned a lot about that. By the 70s and 80s, we got a little cleverer. Roy's third generation models began to put things together, a coupling model, linking the push and the pull. That made sense. And by the 90s, we were really smart. We realized it wasn't just one or two, and it wasn't just the firm. It was the firm in relation to key customers, key suppliers, to key universities as knowledge sources, to finance sources. It began to be a system model, and we began to see the emergence of that concept. But for me, the interesting thing about the paper was Roy's look forward. He talked about five generations. And he looked forward speculatively to a fifth generation. What he suggested was this would be, first of all, a world in which innovation really is global. Many of the players in the 90s were still in the traditional industrialized countries. What Roy was seeing was a much more global distribution, hugely enabled by information technology. Now, 1992, we didn't have much in the way of an internet. So in a sense, he was imagining something which has come to play. But in a sense, what he did was write a sketch map for what has become today's innovation context and suggest that we needed very different kinds of models to cope with that. We needed innovation model innovation. And if you track the literature, of course, you can see this. If we go back to the 90s, we began to see the early discussions of innovation systems. And then, of course, we've now got innovation ecosystems. There's all sorts of elements. Interestingly, if we scan, you not only have a triple helix model involving lots of different players, we've got quadruple, and somebody even suggested a quintuple. I haven't read the paper, but it could be interesting. But in a sense, what this is saying in language is we recognize innovation is much more complex. So really, there's a challenge, first of all, in devising new models, but the real issue is how do we work with them? Learning to work in what is now a system, network, global kind of picture. That's not easy. Challenge number one. So let's move to challenge number two, the spaghetti challenge. Now, I'm delighted to be amongst smart people, and I realize you already know it isn't just the bright idea. In order to make something happen, to create value, and we can't be certain, but in order to make it happen, we need some kind of process. Now, I'm very happy with that picture, not least because it's the kind of thing you'll find in our textbook. But actually, you don't have to look at our textbook. Any other textbooks will have some similar picture. If you hire McKinsey's, they're going to tell you something similar. Essentially, this kind of idea translated through various stages to reality, that's how innovation is. And I'm happy with that, because it gives us a map. And that's very helpful in shaping our thinking, focusing our attention, helping us to manage innovation. As long as we don't forget one really important point. This is a map. Any map is a lovely, simple representation. It's not the place. And of course, the reality is innovation doesn't happen like that. It happens like that. Now, don't worry if you can't see detail, that's quite deliberate. I'd like you to see spaghetti, because that's what innovation really is. Knowledge spaghetti. It's technical knowledge, and market knowledge, and legal knowledge, and financial knowledge, all sorts of strands of knowledge held by different people inside and increasingly outside the organization. And what we have to do is to weave those strands of spaghetti together to create value. Commercial or social value. That's what innovation is, creating value through knowledge spaghetti. Now, we can superimpose on this various structures, of course we do. Let's not, however, forget what's going on underneath. And the reason why this is a particularly important challenge now is that we're drowning in knowledge. We've only got a few indicators, but they're useful enough. One is we've got some sense of how much knowledge is being created around the world in a technical sense. We've got figures from the OECD and others that suggest that every year we spend about $1,600 billion on R&D. Now, that number is vast. And basically, if you say that's a huge number and it's spread all around the world, our challenge moves not to do we create enough, do we do enough ourselves, is have we any idea what's out there and how we might connect to that? And of course, the same is true on the market side. We know quite a lot about a billion people because we've got a lot of market research in the industrialized countries about their wants and needs. There are another 6 billion people on the planet who we don't really understand yet. But they happen to be in the emerging markets. It's where the growth is. It's where huge change is going to happen around the innovation agenda. And we hardly yet begin to understand the spaghetti over there. So we're in a world where this knowledge spaghetti challenge, which has always been there, has really flared up. Massive explosion in knowledge, but there's some good news if we're in the innovation field. We've got a label for this problem. It's the problem of open innovation. Now, as you know, Henry Chesbrough did us a great service in 2003 with a book and some very influential articles where he basically brought this into public focus. And paraphrasing Bill Joy, basically, in a world like the one I've just described, even the largest organization has to say to itself, actually, not all the smart people work for us. And as soon as you say that, everything changes. The game shifts because then it's a matter of what do we know that they might want to know? What do they know that we might want to know? It's a very different game. If I were to try and, in one slide, characterize this revolution in thinking, this shift in generation, if you like, going back to Roy Rothwell, it's essentially about networks and flow. Innovation has, of course, always been a multiplayer game. Henry Chesbrough didn't somehow magically discover this. Go back a long way, we know innovation was never a solo act. go right back to the 16th century and so on. But the Renaissance, periods like that, towns like Florence were influential essentially because they were places where knowledge flowed in and out. Essentially, these sorts of models of innovation as a multiplayer game have been around a long time. But it's accelerated over the past few years. Particularly now, trends in terms of R&D, in terms of markets, in terms of relationships between organizations, the game has shifted. It's a multiplayer game, and within that game, the shift is towards flow and dynamics. If you were to characterize the 20th century, one criticism you could make, it was rather static. It was about knowledge production, accumulation, ownership, and then diffusion. By contrast, the picture today is very much more fluid. It's about flows, it's about knowledge trading, it's a dynamic model. It's about connectivity. It's about joining the dots. In a large company like Procter & Gamble, you all know about Procter & Gamble by now because it's been so widely studied, you've basically had a 20-year re-engineering of the mindset. Their original model in the 1990s was research and development, and it did them proud for 150 years. The shift to connect and develop, wonderful slogan, but it's taken them 20 years to work through what does that mean in terms of connections across the company, linking different communities of practice, and with the company extending its networks outside. This pattern, of course, is repeated in all sorts of organizations, big and small, public and private. There's also the challenge of what Andrew Hagerden calls recombinant innovation. The huge opportunity where we already have knowledge and its application well understood in one world, but if you move it across to a different world, you can suddenly start using that knowledge in very different and creative ways, if you can make the connections. And that really highlights the big challenge, the big spaghetti challenge. It's not a labeling challenge, it's making that model work. And we've spent the last 20 years in all sorts of experiments around how do you make open innovation happen? What are the bridges? Who are the brokers? Who are the gatekeepers? How does this thing work? And just a couple of snapshots to remind you of how much that's changed. The innovation contest. Now, innovation contests are, again, not new. We had a problem in Britain and most other countries with the Navy in the 17th and the 18th century, which was that we kept losing our ships. It's a bad thing for a navy to do. In particular, very sadly, in 1707, the British Navy lost four ships right near the coast of Britain, but unfortunately not close enough. They ran aground on rocks, and unfortunately many people died. But basically, this was a big problem. So we need to deal with this problem. And the source of the problem was very clear. We couldn't tell the time. There was no reliable way of measuring time, and therefore, no reliable way of measuring longitude. There's a wonderful book and film about this story, I've just encapsulated. But basically what happened was this was such an issue, the British government said, we will give a prize, in today's money, about $1 million, to anyone who can solve this problem of a reliable, portable chronometer. And that is the winner. You can see it in the Greenwich Museum in London, it's John Harrison's chronometer. But it was basically the consequence of an innovation contest. Back then. Now, Emperor Napoleon III of France understood from his grandfather that an army marches on its stomach. The problem for the French army, of course, is their baguettes. You want to make a nice sandwich, you need butter to go into it. And butter has a habit of going bad. So actually, for an army to move around, what you'd really like is a substitute for butter. And so again, a big prize, a lot of francs for anyone who can invent a substitute for butter. And that is why we have margarine. It's the result of an innovation contest. Now, the point really is, in those days, you had to be Emperor of France to enable that kind of thing to happen. These days, you can set up an innovation contest in an afternoon. There are platforms, there are thousands of contests running as we speak. Here we ask Swarovski, if you've got a good idea for using their wonderful crystals, they'd like to hear from you. There's a competition running. Public sector, the Bavarian government, interested in your ideas on how we can make this a more energy-efficient area. Of course, it's not just contests, innovation marketplaces, essentially taking the idea of eBay into the world of innovation. Classically, the famous one is Innocentive.com, but there are hundreds like that. Innocentive, started by Eli Lilly. Here we are, a pharmaceutical company. We don't know everything. We've worked on some problems for years, and we have no idea how we might get new traction on that. Maybe someone out there does. That's the essence of Innocentive. Seekers, I've got a problem. Looking for solvers, I think I have an answer. And the power of this model is its simplicity. Anybody can be a solver. You could be a 9-year-old schoolboy, 90-year-old retired engineer, anybody in between. Innocentive now have about 250,000 regular solvers. Think of that as an R&D department. That's a vast range. But the interesting thing is it's not then an offer for companies to be lazy and say, huh, we don't need to do R&D, we'll just hire an Innocentive. It doesn't work like that. Excellent research by Karim Lakhani at Harvard, looking at Innocentive as a platform. Basically, what's going on is companies bring their really difficult questions, the ones they've already wrestled with, and they expose it to a very different set of minds. 250 million people, there's a lot of diversity in that. And as a result, you've got all sorts of new traction on old problems. It's broadcasting, it's extending their spaghetti search. And of course, look at any of our smartphones, we've got innovation communities. This is not just a brilliant company, Apple, or if you've got a Samsung phone or whatever. It's not just the company, it's what it represents in terms of this vast community of applications developers. So essentially what's going on in this spaghetti world is a very different pattern. All sorts of other examples, I'm not going to labor the point. Essentially, we've been playing with how to make it happen. It's of course not just online, though the internet has enabled a lot, it's an offline thing as well. But we're beginning to think about how do we make knowledge flow happen. And of course, in the world that this conference represents, a great deal of the experimentation is going on around new models and how they might work. Essentially, what we're trying to do is to learn to work at a system level, beginning to exploit some of the emergent properties. I remember when I was taught engineering systems, systems are greater than the sum of their parts. They have emergent properties. And that's the potential of the open innovation spaghetti world. Okay, let me move to my third challenge, because the challenge there, of course, is how to make that spaghetti world happen. So my third challenge is the Sappho challenge. And don't worry, this is not about Greek poetry. However, this is a picture of a Model T Ford with one slight modification. I don't know if you can see, but this rather enterprising farmer has decided, if I nail a few planks to the side, I can take my goat to market. Another of his friends said, you know, I never use the back seats anyway. I'll throw them out, and now I've got a truck to carry my hay out to the field. And another one said, it's really hard in the winter. Those cast iron metal tires are no use at all in snow. What I need is a Model T snowmobile. Now, these are all real examples of something we know a lot about. Farmers are great improvisational innovators. They have to be. They want things to work because they've got a job to do. They don't mind if it's not perfect, but they're prepared to get stuck in. They're a classic example of user innovators. And we've known a lot about this. It's not just the farming community. Medical devices is an industry hugely driven by users. Imagine the scene in an operating theater, the theater nurse or the doctor saying, you know, for this procedure, what I really want is a retractor with three joints and a little claw at the bottom, and I'd like a fiber optic thing. They've designed the product. They may even have made a prototype. They certainly are bringing much to the story. If you're a manufacturer, listen to them. You've got half your job done already. Now, the extreme version, of course, of that kind of medical picture is the patient. Here's an example of somebody who, like those farmers, really wants the solution. User innovators have a high incentive to innovate. This chap had a high incentive. He was dying. Had a heart condition. He talked to the doctors. They said, there's an operation you could have. It's not got a very good chance of success. He's an engineer. He's got nothing much to lose, and he thinks, I'm going to design a heart valve that will solve the problem. And I'll take the risk. I care about the solution enough. I'll have it implanted. If you know the TED Talk series, you can see this man on a TED Talk. It's a fascinating talk. But basically, he and many other people with his problem are now alive as a result of user innovation. Look at your smartphone. You may or may not realize it's running on Linux software. And of course, Linux is not a product of the Linux Corporation. It's essentially a community of user innovators who for decades have been working to improve software. It's going on all the time. Then the idea of Project Sappho really brings this back into perspective. Project Sappho, go back to Roy Rothwell, it was one of the projects he was associated with, is one of the ways in which we've learned quite a lot about managing innovation. Project Sappho, very simple idea, very elegant methodology. Take an innovation, find a pair of companies who launched it. One succeeded, one failed. Since the innovation is constant, it was how they managed it that differed, and we can learn from that comparison. So it's a very elegant methodology, has been replicated many times, and we've learned a lot about innovation management from it. I think it also should get a prize for the worst acronym for a project. I found somebody at Sussex once, and I got them in a corner and said, tell me what Sappho stands for. He took a deep breath. It's scientific activity predictor by analyzing innovations by studying their patterns of heuristic origin. Just trips off the tongue. But leaving that aside, Project Sappho taught us a huge amount about innovation, and probably the most important message, users matter. Now, back in the 70s, pay attention to markets, and you'll be a more successful innovator. But more generally, and in 2015, users aren't passive. They never have been, especially they aren't passive in services. And this is a message that organizations are increasingly getting as they adapt their innovation models. A company like Lego. Now, Lego, you know, whoops, wonderfully successful business, right back in the early days, 2000, did a little pilot project, an experiment. Never mind all the products you can buy from us from the shop, how about you send us your favorite picture? Maybe it's your pet or your grandson or whatever. Send us a picture that's specific to you. We'll digitize that. We'll work out how you'd put different Lego bits together to create a three-dimensional mosaic of what you sent us. Now, by definition, that's one-on-one. That's a customized product, premium price. It was never going to sell millions. That wasn't the point. It was an investment in learning for Lego. Wind that forward a few years, and you have something many of you might have seen as parents, Lego Factory. My kids loved this. Lego Factory basically said, well, you can buy Star Wars or Bionicles from us, but maybe you've got an idea. So design your own toy, send us a sketch, use some design tools we put on the web, you design the toy, and we'll make it. So they're beginning now to engage the creativity of the kids as part of the process. Bring that forward to where they are today. And essentially, Lego Kuso says, well, what if we added the Facebook functionality to that? Because we realize when we had Lego Factory, lots of other kids say, hey, that's a cool robot, I want one of those. So let's display kids' ideas and allow them to vote. And so you can see these are getting thousands of likes. And when you hit the magic number of 10,000, there's a pretty clear message to Lego that it might be worth making that product because there's a lot of people who might buy it. But if you're doing that, you've now got a kid somewhere designing it, perhaps you need to actually pay them a royalty. The line between company and user begins to blur. This is what I want for my birthday. Anybody taking notes? It's a 3D printer. I'm a bit nerdy. I'm still an engineer at heart. But 3D printing, of course, is another part of this revolution because it enables users in grown-up world, as well as in Lego world, to realize their ideas. Now, you don't have to have one of these in your bedroom. You can go online. This is the equivalent of the Lego Factory for grown-ups. Anything you can think of, Shapeways or Quirky or many others, will allow you to get it made. We can now realize our ideas. So this is the real Sappho challenge. It's what Eric von Hippel, who of course is the godfather of this field, has researched it for 40 years. It's what he calls the democratization of innovation. And what it's doing is bringing that user right into the center. And lots of different tools and techniques enabling us now in this spaghetti world to engage with users. They aren't passive. But it does beg one other question, which is, which users? And one of the interesting things that von Hippel and others work on is the notion of extreme users. People at the edge whose needs today are not the mainstream. They're exceptions. They may be under conditions of crisis, or they want something nobody else wants. That's them today. But tomorrow, that could be the mainstream. Now, of course, any of you familiar with Clayton Christensen's work on disruptive innovation, that's what that's about. Disruptive innovation, which can sometimes be game-changing, doesn't start in the mainstream. By definition, it starts right at the edge. It's a bunch of people who want stuff that nobody else wants, or a bunch of people who can't afford what everyone else has. And that's a hugely important message for us in innovation, because we maybe should be looking there as well as here as we bring the user in the equation. Let me introduce you to one of my heroes, very briefly. This is a man called Dr. Venkataswamy. One of the reasons he's my hero is he's a silver entrepreneur. So he didn't start his entrepreneurial career until he'd finished his full-time job, which was as an eye surgeon. He spent his life in a clinic in India, essentially doing cataract surgery. Now, anybody who knows about eyes, one of the problems, sadly, we have is a cataract. Something forms, a growth forms over the eye, and eventually you can't see through. Two cataracts, if you don't treat them, you go blind. Now, this is not a difficult medical procedure. I say that advisedly. We have a simulator in my local hospital, and I've been allowed to do a cataract operation, not a real one, but a simulation. You basically take out the cataract and the lens, you put an artificial lens in, you make sure it doesn't get infected, and the patient can see again. The problem that he faced was essentially an economic one. If you have a cataract operation done in London, it will cost $3,000, about. If you have that done in Mumbai, in India, it could cost about $300. If you're like 40% of the Indian population and you earn less than $2 a day, you go blind. That was his motivation as a social entrepreneur. I want to change this. I want to somehow spend the rest of my life bringing eye care to those people. And he did some good innovation work, target costing. If I'm going to make this work, I've got to get the price of this operation down to $30 from the $300 it currently is in the hospital I work in. Now, he also thought, this is not going to be something I find a solution for in the medical world. I've got to look further. Classic recombinant innovation, because he found an answer. Looked far and wide, he found his answer under McDonald's golden arches. Now, whatever you think about McDonald's as a product, think of what they do. Pretty much anywhere in the world, using largely unskilled people, you train them narrowly in one area, you know those stars, and you basically have a standard product which you get really good at doing, and it's available at low cost. Now, of course, the McDonald's people didn't invent that. They learned all of that from Henry Ford. And Henry Ford learned a lot of his stuff from the meat packet. It's recombinant innovation. But what Dr. V did was to take these ideas to eye care. So if you look at the Aravind system now, first of all, it's not like the hospitals you and I are familiar with. It's probably not even a physical building. It's a tent. It takes the hospital to where it's needed. Patient is prepared by a largely unskilled person who's just been narrowly trained, wheeled in, sterilized, anesthetized. The surgeon, the expensive piece of the equation, very quick operation. Patient's wheeled out, looked after, made sure the infection doesn't happen, by again, someone narrowly trained. By which time, another patient's wheeled in, gone. By which time, another patient. This is like a factory, much more like a factory, but it works. Productivity, of course, in that kind of system goes through the roof. The average cost of that operation now is $25. Now, that's amazing because it starts to hit the target, but my medical friends say, oh, yes, but it can't be safe. The infection rates, which is a good measure of quality, are better in the Aravind system than most European hospitals. This stuff works. Importantly, millions of people can see as a consequence of this. They do about 250,000 of these operations every year, so there's a real experience base. And if you think about this, it's not just eyes. It could be knee replacement, hip replacement, all kinds of things. Heart bypass surgery. Another surgeon, Devi Shetty, has essentially applied these principles to really complex operations. Essentially, it's the knowledge spaghetti at work, but it's also entrepreneurs challenging because they're coming from extreme conditions. Very interesting report from McKinsey about the potential of this stuff that begins in the crisis over there, but could have impact over here. So there's this challenge again around the Sappho side, the user side. Now, I could carry on throwing down challenges, but I'm going to be running out of time fairly soon. I'm still right for... Okay. What I'd like to try and do is draw these strands together. So here's a classic business school. I work in a business school, 2x2 matrix. But essentially, what I want to do is to use this as a way of framing where we might be today in terms of the challenges we face. So I'll build the picture up very easily. This is the innovation axis, okay? And I hope by now you're comfortable with incremental to radical. We get that. What I want to put on the horizontal axis, though, is which bits of the environment do we put in there? Now, by definition, no organization can look at everything. We just don't have the bandwidth. So classically, what we do is we frame things. We have a selection environment. The competitors to watch, the customers we want to understand, the technologies we want to monitor. We put these things into a frame. And within that frame, we then manage innovation. And of course, these days, we know it's not simply the firm, it's the system, it's the ecosystem. So it's the government policy, it's the university-company interaction, it's all the different players in the system. At the incremental level, if we can't do that, we shouldn't be around. This is improving what we've already got, it's incremental improvement, but we can also push the frontiers. We know a lot about this. It's the kind of stuff we can teach and essentially is absolutely embedded in the kind of audience we've got here in terms of what you do. What about the other side, though? What happens when we start to move into this green zone? Well, we bring different elements in. We bring, for example, the 6 billion people who we don't fully understand. Or we spread our technology net much more widely. What happens as we move into that space? And more importantly, how, as practitioners, might we work in that space? So what I'm absolutely not saying is the left-hand side is wrong. Absolutely not. That's what we have. That's what we can manage well. We can still improve it, but we know that bit. We need to add to our models ways of working on the right-hand side. So what I'd like to do for my last 5 minutes or so is send some postcards from the green area, from the frontier. And the first postcard I'd like to briefly send is around the dynamics of innovation. How does the process actually happen? We know how it happens in the left-hand side. We've been doing that a long time. How does it happen on the right-hand side? Well, partly, it's about co-evolution, co-creation, emergence. This is a complex system, multiplayer, and we cannot predict the outcome. If you want a metaphor for that, think about the children's bouncing castle. Children's birthday party, children bouncing on a castle. You all know that picture. If you put one child on the council, on the castle, let them bounce, you can predict. It's simple physics, you can predict. If they land here, they'll go over there. That's ballistics. Put two children on, and it becomes more complex because what one does affects the other. But you can sort of predict it. Put 10 children on, and it's chaos. Bounce, bounce, boing, boing, boing. It's not, however, complete chaos. What we understand from complexity theory is there are moments when two children hit the same point, and then there's a dip, and the other children fall into it. Things happen in this space, but it's a very different pattern. It's much more co-evolution, emergence, interaction. So how we work in that space essentially is not about predicting this is what we're going to do and doing. It's about probing, and it's trying to sense what's going on and react to what's going on. It's prototyping, it's fast learning, it's very much this rather entrepreneurial approach. If we take complexity theory, three things become relevant. We have to understand the context of the user, we have to be in there. We have to be in there early enough to detect changes and understand what's going on out there. And we have to be in there actively, providing the opportunities to experiment and prototype around that space. Now this is happening. In the world that you're working in, we can see versions of this. We teach, of course, in Lean Startup all about prototyping, this kind of designing experiments. But we're beginning to see a new role for universities, for example. My old friend Alan Hughes at Cambridge talks a lot about the way universities affect innovation. And actually, the spin-off is important, but a fairly small piece. One of the big pieces is we educate people and they become carriers of knowledge. But another thing he draws attention to is the university as the convener of a public space, a place where experiments and ideas can interact. And this is beginning to happen. I've just come back from Nuremberg, and any of you who have a bit of time in Germany, I'd recommend you drop down there. There's a cooperation between the University of Erlangen and Nuremberg and the Fraunhofer Institute, the big one that invented the MP3. But basically, they've set up a shop right in the middle of downtown Nuremberg, a bit like an Apple store. And the premise is simple. Drop in, have a nice cup of coffee. There's a very nice coffee bar there. But participate in live prototyping. Companies are bringing stuff there, not as finished products they want to sell, but these are our ideas. What do you think? Chip in your ideas. What do you think we could do with this? It's essentially creating a boundary space around which that kind of prototyping can happen. It's building a very different kind of bridge to help work on that right-hand side, because the dynamics of innovation are very different over there. Second postcard, briefly, new roles. In a sense, in the spaghetti world, we've seen the rise of a whole service sector. I guess many of you in the room are from this new service sector around making connections, bridges, connectors, brokers, enabling this interchange of the knowledge spaghetti and essentially understanding how knowledge flows and how we might help that happen. Lots of things going on. I was at a presentation last week by PA Consulting. Now, some of you might know PA. It's one of the Cambridge phenomena. Began life as a very good product development consultancy. If you want a new product development, you could get them and they'd do a good job for you. PA's business model now is really interesting. It's playing as a knowledge platform. They still do what they always did, custom work for you, designing and helping you develop a product. They learn enough that they design and develop their own products. They also learn that other people out there have ideas, and they understand the innovation process, so bringing their experience of the innovation process and their money to small-scale entrepreneurs and helping them scale things is a win-win. And they're now beginning to advise hedge funds and others about which players to back. They're playing right across this knowledge space. It's a very different business model where knowledge is at the center. And you may know Andrew Hagerden's work, very widely written, about IDEO. IDEO is essentially a great business model. You consult for lots of different people in different worlds, and the knowledge you pick up here, you can deploy here. It's like bees buzzing around, cross-pollinating. It's part of this whole different model, understanding knowledge flow. That was my spaghetti picture from earlier, and it wasn't simply a nice dramatic picture. If any of you know the engineering company Arup, they build bridges and other complex structures. They're a very good design and engineering company. This is their brain. Each one of those yellow dots is a person, and this is part of their very sophisticated attempt to understand the social networking of knowledge. Who talks to who about what in creating new things? And as you can see, there are some interesting outliers. There are also some key nodes. And by different kinds of project, the map might change. Now, for me, this is interesting because Thomas Allen, one of the people who influenced my PhD, Thomas Allen was writing in the 1970s, still a professor at MIT, but laid much of the groundwork for this. Understanding how does knowledge flow, and it doesn't flow from everyone to everyone else, it's essentially a social network. And the concept of the gatekeeper is essentially Tom Allen. Understanding the key person who says, you've got something and I know who would benefit from that, making these connections. We're beginning to understand a lot more about brokerage, and that becomes a hugely important part of the new role skill set. How do you find the new stuff? Again, the big challenge. How do you go scouting? If we're saying the knowledge spaghetti is important, how do we find stuff beyond our immediate search space? And increasingly, companies that I talk to are designating managers with a wonderful job description. Go out there, find something useful, bring it back. It's a great job description. But behind it is this idea of how we might actually pick up particularly some of the early warning signals. One company I talked to say, my job is to go to universities and have coffee. I drink a lot of coffee because I don't go to the technology transfer office. I actually go to the departments. I spend some time just listening, getting a sense of what's going on. Now, you could say that's an awfully expensive waste of his time, or you could say this is a smart investment. It's like a football manager going and scouting in the junior divisions. It's not today's star because you can't afford him. It's tomorrow's emerging star. It's scouting, and there are new skills around that. And that magic word had to come. Entrepreneurs. Now, of course, entrepreneurs have always been important in the innovation process, especially in the green zone. But I'd suggest we've got a massive upsurge in thinking about entrepreneurs now. This is no longer just about startups. Many companies I talk with are keen to bring entrepreneurship within, in various forms. My university, along with thousands of others, now decides it's going to be an entrepreneurial university. Great slogan. How do we make it happen? Our students' union want to increase from 2% to 10% the number of students engaged in startups. Not they all want to be Microsofts, not because they all want to be Facebooks, but rather that whole skill set of developing ideas is pretty good on your CV. It increases employability. So in a sense, entrepreneurship, hugely important in this space. And the message, and I see several of the papers deal with this, it's going to be very much something that's influenced by what we can say around the skills of being an entrepreneur. Not just the small number who might start up something, but spreading those skills much more widely in companies across a much larger population. A lot of my work at the moment is with the humanitarian sector. I work with people like the Red Cross. There you have a classic example of what I call naive entrepreneurs. People with really big hearts. They want to change the world. They want to make things better. They may have a great idea for doing it. In terms of how you realize that idea, they really are absolute beginners. There's a great need for transferring those sorts of skills into that space for that kind of environment. And lastly, my very last one, I promise. Am I still right? Okay. New ways of doing it. Anybody gets lucky once. The whole challenge in managing innovation is, can we put procedures, structures, routines in place to help us repeat the trick? So if we're going to work on the left-hand side, we know how to do that. If we're going to work on the right-hand side, what are those going to look like? And the big message, of course, is one size doesn't fit all. It never did. But we need to be looking at multiple parallel activities inside universities, inside companies, inside governments and state bodies who are trying to influence innovation. It's a diverse picture. We have to match that variety. And the challenge that sets up is, of course, then getting everybody to work around the same theme rather than pulling in different directions. The challenge Michael Tushman talks about of ambidexterity, being able to do two different things at the same time. It's part of what Christensen called the innovator's dilemma. Maybe a rather crude metaphor, we might think about the innovation orchestra, not just one solo musician or a small group of string players, but all the different tones doing different jobs to create something. Now, I'll leave that metaphor to hang there, but I think you can fill it out. I'm running out of time. So let me summarize, and then we'll close. The problem has never changed. Innovation's the same problem it always was. How do we create value? Could be social value, could be commercial value, but how do we create value from ideas? That doesn't change, but the context is fundamentally changed. As a student of innovation, I started my research back in the 70s. When I look at it now, there's a kind of divide neatly around the year 2000. And I think the game, the context has massively changed. It's a really exciting place to be, but it's different. And so we need, in responding to this moving target, that wonderful business school term, dynamic capability. But I read that to mean the ability not just to manage innovation, but to step back and reset as the world changes, as the conditions change. This is what I mean by, I'm going to coin this phrase, innovation model innovation. But I genuinely believe we do, and I think Roy Rothwell was onto something right back in the 90s when he suggested it. And of course, the big thing that comes out and is very much embedded in many of the paper titles, it's at a system level now. This is not a solo act. This is also about governance, where we don't own and control everything. We have to find ways of dealing with a very different kind of model. So what do we need to do more of, because it's still relevant and works? What do we need to do less of or even stop, no longer works? What new things do we need to learn? It's all about learning new tricks. And so let me leave my last word to this gentleman. Some of you may have seen him before. If you don't know the picture, this is the original Winnie the Pooh. Never mind Walt Disney's version, this is how he originally looked. Very first book, published in 1920, very first page, for me, says something profound about the challenge of learning. Here you have Edward Bear, that's Winnie the Pooh's proper name, coming downstairs, bump, 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 on the back of his head, behind Christopher Robin, which is, as far as he knows, the only way of coming downstairs, except that sometimes he thinks there really is another way, if only he could stop bumping for a moment to think of it. Absolutely. So, very wise words, but in a sense it brings us right back to where you are. One of the great things about a conference like this is you're not bumping your heads. You've come offline. More important, you've got time to reflect and people to bounce those ideas off. So I wish you well with the rest of the conference. I hope I've planted a few challenges and you feel a tiny bit uncomfortable because you can't answer all of them. But thank you very much for your attention. Thank you. Sure. Thank you.
I really wanted to actually, in the end, bring it all back to your own words. You mentioned something I thought was very interesting. It's something we experience, but it's something we struggle with to bring into reality, and that is the university is a public space. Mm-hmm. I thought that was a really interesting comment. That was your words, and I'm going to use your other words, which are, how do we make it happen? Mm-hmm. And I'm going to ask you that.
Okay, well, first of all, the original concept is Alan Hughes, Professor Alan Hughes at Cambridge, who's written a lot about this whole area that you're working in. And he has this idea, partly because there was a mythology that began to build up that all we needed was lots of spin-offs. Now, spin-offs are important, but they're not the whole story. And what Alan did, and I ran a big research program in which Alan and about 30 other researchers were involved, we looked at the ways universities support innovation. And of course, it's a long, a broad frontier. And some of it's very quiet stuff. The obvious thing is we change people's minds. As we educate, they carry knowledge. So that, in a sense, is the ultimate technology transfer. But the notion of the public space is interesting because we can be proactive. We can do different things with that space. And it's not a new idea. One of the heartening things about British government policy is occasionally we're consistent. Very often, every 5 years, the policy changes. But one policy has stayed, it's changed its name, but has stayed for about 40 years. It used to be called the Teaching Company Scheme. It's now called the Knowledge Transfer Partnership. But it's a brilliantly simple model extending this space. It says, here's a business which needs to learn something. The university has that knowledge. The best way of moving the knowledge is via a person. So the government contribute and the company contributes to the salary costs of a graduate. We employ them, but they spend all their time there. And they become a human bridge. And on day one of what's normally a two-year project, it's all one way and everyone's a bit strange. By the end of 2 years, you've got a two-lane highway going both ways, all sorts of other bits of the university connect with all sorts of other bits of the company. It's a very simple, very elegant way of extending the university space. Similarly, though, this thing I mentioned in Nuremberg, it's a new experiment. Create a shop in the city center, convene a space. But in many ways, there are a lot of other options available and things going on. Maybe we need to frame our thinking that actually part of our role as universities is to provide and organize and stage manage the use of that space.
There was a lot of, we've seen in multiple presentations talking about, increasingly over the last 3 years, about systems and recognition that systems are actually very important. But then you also mentioned we need a space. And when we're talking about a space, we're actually talking about, and you talked about the transfer of a student into the business, we're talking about people, aren't we?
Oh, yeah.
And so what sort of, if we're talking about our knowledge transfer, and we're all involved in on the edge of the university and society, how could we best facilitate this knowledge transfer using, as you said, systems and people?
Okay.
It's a big question.
Big question. I'll try and give a small and a personal answer. I think, first of all, one of the problems we get hung up on is structures. So we think it's got to be a this, it's got to be a that, we need resources for this. Forgetting that what we've always known, right back to my earliest reading on technology transfer, it flows through people. That's how it is. So how can we best embed people? How can we best make use of them? A slightly worrying thing I came across, I was at a conference last week in Budapest. Innocentive is one of the innovation platforms, innovation markets. Nine Sigma is another quite famous one, which again has a very large body of solvers. The good news for universities is 30% of the solutions for problems across that platform come from universities. The slightly less good news for any of you in technology transfer offices is almost none of it comes via the TTO. It's direct from the professor or the researcher into the system, which begins to suggest maybe we haven't yet worked out the ways in which we can bring our smart people together with their problems. So I think it's about people and it's about experimenting with different ways. And my personal view is the more we can make that face-to-face, the more we can have, whether it's shops in the city center or come to the university. The notion of my rapid prototyping machine, of course, many universities have that kind of facility, ours, one example. And our fab lab is beginning to be a way of attracting quite a lot of people in, and then you start the dialogue. It's not the gee whiz technology, it's the attraction to come in the door and then talk to people.
Fantastic. Now, I could keep going on asking you questions, but I think it's really important that we get our audience involved. I'm going to throw it over to the audience. Do we have a couple of people with the microphones? Yep, okay. I think we've got a first question down the front here. Yeah, if you could raise your hand. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Michael Kahn is my name. Thank you for an inspiring talk. You started us off with some humor around utility patents. But in the rest of your talk, you didn't say very much about the problem of intellectual property rights and the restrictions and the increasing closing down of that space. Yeah. Perhaps you could share your ideas with us. Thank you.
Ideas, certainly. I mean, I stressed, I'm someone who's loved the innovation field ever since. As a frustrated engineer, I couldn't understand why innovation didn't work when we had the right ingredients, smart people, plenty of money. And I began to want to know why, and I've stayed in that field. So if I come to your particular question, in this spaghetti world, it has huge implications for intellectual property. We know that. I think the challenge we face, if I were to put it very crudely, is we've got a system that was designed around, well, King Henry VIII had a hand in the patent system. It was a great system whose time may have come. What we replace it with, we're still experimenting with. But I suspect that our current models of intellectual property protection certainly aren't sufficient and probably may no longer be along the right lines. Don't ask me what the new ones are. I can point you to experiments and so on. But I think not least what we've seen in the world of music and now rapid prototyping, anything you see around the room, in the streets outside, you think, I like that. You can take a photo. You can get the design information from that and get it made. So what we saw in music and film is just the tip of a huge iceberg. So in a sense, intellectual property issues are huge. A couple of comments. In the brokerage space, the smart players realize this is a part of the story. So one company I think do rather well in this space basically have an idea of an airlock. And they say, actually, it would be absolutely stupid for you to talk to them and just share your ideas and your knowledge. What we have to do is create the safe space within which there's high levels of trust, around which you can talk, and maybe something will come. Now, that's a move in a new direction. Another model is the notion of a trusted intermediary. One company I know in the UK plant quite experienced doctoral-level technologists in companies, and then periodically they have a kind of reunion. So from different companies, public and private sector, they bring and discuss the needs and the potential means. But they are trusted intermediaries. They carry a huge responsibility. This is part of the brokerage, which I think we still have to evolve. I'm not sure we can design a system, an IPO or something, which can deal with all of that, given the high variety in there. But I absolutely agree this is a hugely important part of the spaghetti story.
One thing you just mentioned, which I think is something that I'd like to touch on a little bit more, is the current intellectual property options that we actually have. And you look at, for example, the social sciences and humanities, where there's a lot of tacit knowledge and there's a lot of tacit knowledge that can be exchanged, can be transferred. Mm. How could you see that going forward to really benefit from this full knowledge that we have at universities?
Okay, so I think there's two sides of this question. How do we protect and manage that? I'm not sure, but I think we're developing, they're evolving. But I think there's a more fundamental question, which is, in the 1990s, we had a big fashion for knowledge management. And that actually was mostly about databases. What do we know? What's in the database? It's there. We know it. We own it. We're much better, I think, now, because we realize it's a knowledge flow game. And to play in that game, whatever we're playing, whether we're a university or a company or whatever, we need to think about what's the value of knowledge? What do we know that we really need to hold on to? What do we know that someone else might benefit from? We can trade with that. What does everybody know, and therefore we needn't worry about? And in a sense, beginning to do this kind of knowledge accounting and beginning to think about ways in which we can play the knowledge game, I think is happening. Your point about the social sciences, of course, is particularly relevant because we've never thought about that. You know, it's one thing if you're in the hard technology world, not so much. But one of my colleagues at Cardiff is trying to set up a social science park as part of their big investment. And part of the thinking there is to develop the skills around intellectual property in the social sciences.
Interesting. Questions? Up the back. Yeah. Please introduce yourself when you ask a question, please.
Mario Blanco, King Abdullah University of Science and Technology. Thank you very much for a very enlightening lecture. Earlier on in your lecture, you alluded to the difference between invention and innovation, and that's very clear. And we're still patenting for 17 or 20 years, and the product lifetime is getting very, very short, sometimes years, sometimes months. So when innovation speeds up, is there a danger or a point where the life cycle of a product will be threatened so that you may not recover your expenses on, you know, on product development? What are your comments on that?
Okay, again, comments. I think that is happening increasingly. And the more we move into this spaghetti world where there's multiple development of ideas going on across potentially 7 billion people, you know, it becomes a really big thing, the more that's going to accelerate. What I suspect that's going to mean is the notion of getting the value, but capturing the value from your intellectual investment may lie less in patents and more in other ways of doing it. Being early in the marketplace, having a dominant design, having freemium kind of models where you add value-adding services and things to it. I think we're going to move into quite a lot of innovation in that space. But I think particularly in the product world, the whole trend towards opening it up is eventually going to lead to the kind of picture you paint.
Thanks. My name is Charlotte from Swisscore. I have a question concerning your new innovation dynamics. You were talking about fast failures and that's really important. Mm-hmm. However, we are struggling with a culture in Europe which doesn't allow a lot of failure. So how are we going to tackle this huge problem?
It's a great question. The problem of fast failure, anyone who looks at lean startup and so on, that's one of the great phrases. It's a real challenge. And back to my humanitarian work, I mean, that's a space where, like in the public sector, failure is a really bad thing. People's lives might depend on it. I have a doctoral student, and I've not seen it elsewhere, but he's got a rather nice phrase. He talks about intelligent failure. And I think that's quite a nice adjective because we do learn from failure. When I go back to my very first days as a lab assistant, the whole principle of science is you design experiments and they will fail, from which you learn. And it's this, you know, it's now been built into Lean Startup. Intelligent failure is you don't make the same mistakes twice, you don't take stupid risks, you design the experiments carefully. But it's essentially recognizing failure, particularly on my right-hand side, where we just don't know, we're probing. Failure's going to be a part of that. Managing that and also taking away any of the stigma that attaches, you know, the fact you could lose your job or, you know, it's career threatening if you're part of a failed project. So I like that phrase, intelligent failure.